our librarian, Ellen Carey.
Thank you. Thanks, everyone. How are you all doing? Good. Okay, so the way we're going to do this, I'm going to talk for, I'm aiming for 15 minutes, which means it will probably be 20. And if you have any questions that are points of clarification as I'm talking, feel free to ask them, interrupt me, raise your hand, shout it out, whatever. And probably raise your hand and shout it out if I don't hear, if I don't notice you. But if you have more deeper questions or philosophical questions or things that are going to require more discussion, just save those for the end of my presentation, and we'll have a little bit of time for questions then. And then after Dr. Napoleon speaks, we'll have more time for questions for her, as well as if there's any questions that you'd like to address to both of us. Does that make sense? Okay, so we're here to talk about pseudoscience and scientific literacy. And because I'm a librarian, I also think in terms of media literacy and information literacy. So I thought we would start off with some definitions of each of those things. So definition of pseudoscience. So a system, this is from Merriam-Webster's dictionary, a system of theories, assumptions, and methods erroneously regarded as scientific. Okay, helpful, but what do we mean by scientific? Sometimes when we're talking about scientific, we talk about the scientific method. So I have a definition of that too, which has to do with pursuing knowledge by identifying a problem or a question, gathering information about it, formulating a hypothesis, testing that hypothesis through observation or experimentation, and interpreting the results. So if pseudoscience is something that is erroneously regarded as scientific, it could either be the content, the information itself, something that's not actually factual based on the scientific evidence, or it could be the process. It could be a process of gathering information that doesn't rely on the scientific method, but claims to in some way. Does that make sense? So that's where we're starting with those definitions. I also want to talk about the different literacies. So scientific literacy, this is a very long definition. I'm not going to read all of it, but I will point out some key points. So it has to do with knowledge and understanding of scientific concepts and processes, being able to ask, find, and determine answers to questions derived from curiosity about everyday experiences, the ability to describe, explain, and predict natural phenomena, being able to read and understand scientific articles, or at least articles about science in the popular literature, and to be able to engage in social conversation about that. And finally, to be able to evaluate the quality of the scientific information you encounter. And you'll see in a moment that that has a lot of overlap with definitions of media literacy and information literacy. So media literacy has to do with being able to analyze, access, evaluate, create information, participate with media messages, and also understanding the role that the media plays in society, and being able to hone your skills for inquiry. And information literacy, there's a lot of them. So a lot of aspects of these definitions. So information literacy has to do with being able to discover information, like we were just talking about with media literacy, but also, like with media literacy, to be able to understand where information comes from in the first place. How is it produced? How is it accessed? How do we, what are all of the things that go into providing access to information and taking advantage of that access? And also, how is it valued by different groups? And I think that's key, the how is it valued by different groups. In every different field, even within the sciences, certainly between the sciences and the social sciences and the humanities, there are going to be different experts' opinions on, or different sort of disciplinary opinions on how, what makes information valuable, what makes it credible. So that's another aspect of information literacy, is understanding that from the perspective of our different disciplines. and being able to use information to create new knowledge. Just like with media literacy, where part of media literacy is not just being a consumer of media, but being a producer of it, same with information literacy. We're producing knowledge, not just consuming it. And finally, to participate ethically in all of this. So there are some common elements. So engaging in inquiry, analyzing and critically evaluating information, understanding how and why a source was created, using information to gain knowledge and better understand the world, and participating intelligently and ethically. And if you look at the center of the Venn diagram, all of those things really have to do with critical thinking. So all of these literacies mean engaging with the information we discover in the world, and in this case, the scientific information, in a critical way. Which of these lines is longer, the horizontal lines? Which of them feels longer? The bottom one, right? So your brain is a liar. This is an example, just one example, visual one, an optical illusion, an example of how our brain tricks us. So there's lots of other ways that our brain tricks us. This one's pretty easy to figure out. Like, how could we figure out which of those lines is actually longer?
Measure it.
Boom, we've done a scientific experiment. But when we're talking about more complex information, something we maybe don't know a lot about or don't have the means to go and evaluate on our own or test on our own, scientific information we're encountering in the media, how does our bias affect us? So there's this concept of cognitive bias. And if you Google this, you will find dozens of different cognitive biases that I'm sure lots of different social scientists have researched this, and scientists. There's a lot in psychology about the role of cognitive bias in things like decision making, our understanding and beliefs about the world. I'm just going to show you a couple. So there's confirmation bias. That's when, does anyone know what confirmation bias is? No, so that's when, did you want to? Right. If I already have a belief and I hear something that confirms that belief, I'm going to remember that information better than something that that doesn't confirm that belief. So for example, if I believe that pit bulls are just naturally more aggressive and more likely to attack humans than other dogs, I am going to, that notion is going to be reinforced by the information I take in, because I'm going to be more likely to seek out, to engage with, and to interpret as true the information that confirms that assumption I already have. And I'm going to be more likely to dismiss the information that contradicts it. So that's why the la la la, I can't hear you. another kind of confirmation bias is the illusory truth effect, or similar to what Stephen Colbert called truthiness, which is sort of the cognitive bias, or the response to information that's similar to the response to that horizontal line. It just feels true. Even if I encounter lots of information that contradicts it, it just feels true. And that's the illusory truth effect. And there's been some really interesting research on this one in particular that has shown that even when, so it was theorized, and some studies, this is where studies sometimes disagree with each other, some studies had shown that prior knowledge could be a mitigating effect on the illusory truth effect. So if I already know something about it, if I already know that the Atlantic Ocean is not the biggest ocean on Earth, no matter how many times I hear it and how much it's repeated by people that I find credible that the Atlantic Ocean is the biggest, I would still be like, no, I already knew this, it's not. Well, there's at least one study that actually found that that's not true, scarily, that even if you have prior knowledge, just the repetition itself of something that is not true over time, again and again, you're bombarded with that information, you will start to believe it. And I actually have a personal story about this, which is when I was, so now I'm going to date myself, I was 5 when the moon landing happened in 1969. And that was a huge thing in my childhood. Like, I was old enough to remember it. It was really cool. Fast forward 20 years, I'm in my mid-20s. I was hanging out with some friends who are a little older than I was, 5 to 10 years older. And they're like, you don't remember that. That happened in 1964. I'm like, no, I'm positive I remembered it. By the end of this party, I believed them, that I had made up that memory, because there were so many of them at this party who had told me, you can't possibly remember it, it happened in 1964. And this was in the days where it wasn't so easy to just, we didn't have the internet, I can just go Google it and look it up. So I just believed them. It was years later before I was like, hey, wait a minute, the moon landing did happen in 1969, I do remember that. So that's just one example of how powerful these cognitive biases can be. There's also, and you've probably heard about this, media bias in scientific reporting. Also, lots of different kinds of media bias. One, and I was hoping this would show up big enough that people could see it, false balance. So this is when, usually balance in reporting is a good thing, right? You want to hear from voices on lots of different sides of an issue. That's a good thing for journalists to strive for. But often the way it plays out is this sort of setting up false oppositions. Global warming is a good example. So the vast majority of scientists agree that global warming is a thing, climate change is a thing, and humans have contributed to it. But many journalists still, if they're presenting something, writing something about climate change, they're going to hear from the opposition, a climate change denier. Even though those things really don't have equal weight. The science has demonstrated again and again that it is a thing, and most scientists believe it. So it sets up in the public's minds, or the reader or viewer's mind, the idea that each are equally valid. The idea that climate change is a thing, and the idea that climate change is not a thing. Another example of media bias is questionable experts. And this is a really important one when you're doing research for school or for your own interest. Just because someone is Dr. So-and-so, or you know, so-and-so has a big title, doesn't mean they're an expert in the thing that they're talking about. So in this little cartoon, there, the difference between, well, the dentist saying, well, I've thought about this a lot, and I believe such and such. You know, if this, again, were the global warming thing, okay, the dentist is Dr. So-and-so, but is global warming his area of expertise? No. So that's another thing that you'll see in the media a lot, questionable experts. Another kind of media bias, oversimplification. This one's tricky, right? Because the very nature of popular media is it's taking when it's reporting science, it's taking very complex information and simplifying it for a general audience. That's important. Most of us can't understand the original texts that are describing the science, the original scholarly journal articles. So they need to be simplified and interpreted for us in some way. But that often becomes too much of an oversimplification. Too many assumptions are being made that are not really accurate. Another one is mistaking correlation for causation. What's the difference between correlation and causation? The difference is everything. I love that. The difference is everything. Correlation just means they're happening at the same time. Causation means one caused the other. So there, this is from a website that is one of my favorite websites ever. It's called Spurious Correlation. It's hilarious. And so it graphs these things that correlate with each other, but clearly don't cause each other. Although I do think it's entertaining to think whether the divorce rate in Maine causes the decline in the per capita consumption of margarine, or whether it's the other way around. But this is something we will see. This is a particular pet peeve of mine, so I see this in the media all the time. People assuming that because two things are correlated, it means that sorry for that, means that one is causing the other, not the case. And then we have, this is kind of related to the oversimplification, what I call the telephone effect. You know the game telephone, where you whisper something to someone and they whisper something to someone else? The further you get away from the source of the scientific information, the more likely it's going to get distorted and misinterpreted. And when you're, actually I'll show you the next slide, how this sometimes happens. No, I lied, it's not on the next slide. We'll do this first. So what do? We already talked about this, but we can, in some cases, do our own scientific test. We can measure the lines and determine that they really are the same length. Or we can understand how and why a source was created and who created it. So this is, there's lots of things that go into, as you saw, the scientific and media and information literacy. But if you start with this, you're going to be going a long way toward avoiding pseudoscience and inaccurately reported science scientific information. So this is the scientific method again. See, one of the elements on it is communicating the findings. So how do scientists do that? We have a scientist out discovering a cool new species in the ocean. It gets published in a scholarly journal, right? Does everyone know what a scholarly journal is? So it's written by experts, reviewed by other experts, usually read by experts too, or by students of that field. And eventually it gets to some late night TV show that's like, ooh, weird new species. I would like to argue that there's actually another step, or at least one more step in this, that it will often be reported in more credible popular media, like the New York Times science section, before it gets to a sort of sensationalized, this is a weird thing, kind of stage. So the biggest thing that you can do to save yourself from pseudoscience is to learn to distinguish between these two different types of popular sources. To learn to distinguish the credible, reliable reporting of scientific information in the media and the more sensationalized. And part of that is understanding what the motivations are for why the information is put out there, created in the first place. So at this, the scientific journal level, why is that published? What are the reasons?
To inform,
right? I'm a scientist. I went and found this cool new species. I'm informing others in the field. It's part of an ongoing scholarly communication with my peers about my work, right? Why are popular sources reporting on this?
To make money.
Certainly to make money. And in different ways. Certainly the New York Times is making money. Hopefully they also have a mission to inform and an intention to inform. But this late night TV show, who knows? Or maybe it's a website that's like, cool new species found. It's poisonous. Protect yourself from it by buying our new poison protection, you know? Or, cool new species found. Yum. We're selling it. Buy some. It's delicious. You know, so there's different motivations. So investigating the motivation behind why information is put out there in the first place and who put it out there, is it the scientists themselves or is it someone reporting the science or is it someone reporting it second or third or fourth hand, that's an important strategy. And then here's just a list of specific things that you can do to evaluate questions you can ask, things you can look into to evaluate information. This is really valuable to do with any information, not just scientific information, but identifying the stage at which you're jumping into this process. So, oops, I thought I could go back, and I can't, but hopefully, here we go. So where am I in this process? Where am I in that game of telephone? How am I getting this just second hand, or am I getting it third hand? So how can I tell that? Some of the things I can look for, the characteristics of quality reporting, include acknowledging the complexities of the original research, so not oversimplifying it, not saying there's causation when really there's no evidence of that, placing the scientific information in a larger context, so not just cool new yummy species, buy it from us, but what does this mean scientifically? Why is this important? How does it fit within the other science in this area? And especially, this is so important, do they identify the original researchers by name? Do they provide a link or at least a citation for this study? It's amazing, and I think Dr. Napoleon will probably show us several examples of pseudoscience online that refers to studies, but doesn't give you enough information to actually go and follow up on it on your own. Checking out multiple sources, things like the New York Times that you know, in general, at least have the mission to be reliable. And approaching all information, including your own assumptions, remembering the cognitive bias, approaching all of that with some skepticism and a commitment to critical thinking. And then, of course, always staying curious and continuing to ask questions. So that is all I have for you, unless you have questions for me. Thank you.
All right.
Thanks.
Does anybody have any questions for our librarian before we move on to Dr. Napoleon? And now, ladies and gentlemen, I want to introduce our other presenter, someone who is really well known on this campus, an outstanding scientist. She's an assistant professor of chemistry, and she often brings her own lecturers and speakers from outside. I've attended a couple of them. So she's really a dynamic person for a life of ideas, and I refer to, of course, Dr. Napoleon.
Thank you.
Are you all
wired
up?
Yeah. Thank you for that kind introduction. Thank you for all of my students and my friends that are here tonight. It's really nice to be here and do this. Something I'm very passionate about, my focusing and ideas about pseudoscience and science denialism. So I'm really excited to share this with all of you because I don't get to talk about it in class enough. I always want to go on these tangents, and my students can tell you I certainly do, but it's still not enough, and so I get to have your full attention tonight and just go to town. So here we are. So thanks for being here. So as I start my talk tonight, I just want to say something that is very, very true, but that might be quite shocking for you in case you've never considered it and in case you've never thought about it, in case you've never heard of it before. This is the greatest time in human history. Homer Simpson looking at the stars. It's true. This is the greatest time in human history on this planet. Not that there's human histories on other planets, but never mind, I'm getting off topic, right? By any measurable means, wealth, architecture, mobility, lifespan, declining rates of poverty, disease, social acceptance, I would argue, an abundance of 24-hour gyms, availability of pharmacies, liquor stores, right? But I think what I'm leaving off my list is probably one of the most obvious ones, and that's life expectancy. Right? Life expectancy has been getting longer and longer and longer. As a matter of fact, just to give you a little bit of my family history, my great-grandparents died in their 40s. Okay? So my great-grandfather on my father's side, Donato Napoleon, died during a flu epidemic. He was in his 40s. My great-grandmother died during childbirth. So when those two people died, my grandfather was an orphan in his teens. My grandparents, as he grew older and got married, my grandparents on my father's side, they died in their 70s. Now, my father's a bit of an anomaly. He died in his 50s. He had lung cancer. He was a smoker. So that's a little out of you know, the trajectory where most people are going. But my mother is currently in her 70s, and based on statistics, based on how things are going, she'll probably live into her 80s, if not her early 90s. So I was looking up some statistics for you all, right? 100 years ago, so it's 2017, 100 years ago, in 1917, in the US, the average lifespan of a man was 48.4 years. Now, that's not a very long time, right? Now, that's only 100 years ago, right? If you rank countries based on life expectancy, rank them 1 through, I think it's 186 or something like that, the worst country in the world, according to life expectancy only, is Sierra Leone. So a baby boy in Sierra Leone today can expect to live longer than the average man 100 years ago in the US, right? So that's a pretty interesting thing to think about. So why is that true? Why was the life expectancy 100 years ago so much different than the life expectancy now? Now, there's a number of factors here, right? And I can't, and I'm going to oversimplify it, right? You know, you can look at nutrition and access to healthcare and all of those things. But a big one, and the most obvious one, I think, is eradication of diseases that used to wipe people out, specifically flus, like which got my great-grandfather, and also smallpox. Now, I should have warned you at the very beginning, but I'm going to warn you now just so that you know. I have some graphic photos in my talk, and so I'm going to show you a graphic photo now. So here's smallpox. Smallpox has killed billions of people. In the 20th century alone, according to the World Health Organization, smallpox has killed between 300 and 500 million people. That is more people killed than any war. Let's talk about smallpox, since we probably don't know a lot about it. Smallpox is an infection that goes straight to the small blood vessels. It originally starts out as a rash that develops into the raised fluid-filled blisters that you're seeing on this child here. 30 to 35% of the people infected with smallpox will die. A third of the people infected with it will die. And even if you don't die, you get scarring. 60 to 85% of people infected with smallpox get scarring, blindness, limb deformities, the list goes on, right? Not a great disease. But it's gone. Nobody knows anyone in here that's ever had smallpox, I can guarantee you, right? It was gone. It's globally eradicated in 1979. It's one of two infectious diseases that have been successfully eradicated, the other one being rinderpest. Anyone hear of it? Robbie, keep your hands down. My microbiologist. Yeah. We know. Anyone else? No? Exactly, me neither. So what caused these eradications of these diseases? Vaccines. And I'd like to take a step back for just a second. In looking up the life expectancy of people 100 years ago, in 1917, I found a long list of the life expectancy of everyone in every year in America, in the US. So I gave you the statistics for 1917. What was interesting is that immediately after 1917, clearly, comes 1918. The life expectancy in 1917 was 48.4 years. The life expectancy of a man in 1918, 36.6 years. What caused such a significant drop in life expectancy for humans in that 1 year period? The flu, right? The flu that year alone killed between 500 and 100 million people. It was one of the most deadliest natural disasters ever. So what am I getting at here? Showing you scary pictures, giving you horrible statistics, right? Diseases that killed people just a generation ago no longer exist, like smallpox, or are thought of as a normal everyday, or not everyday, but normal every season occurrence, right? Oh, it's flu season, right? Anybody scared of being one of 100 million people of dying of the flu, right? How lucky are we, right? Like I said, we live in great, great times. Diphtheria, rubella, polio. Does anybody know anyone with any of these diseases? Have you ever seen these diseases firsthand? One, two, okay, a few, right? It took me 26 years to meet the first person ever I saw that was infected with polio. It was in grad school at Boston University. It was a postdoc in my lab. His name was Wonsun. He was from Korea. He was permanently disabled and had to walk on crutches. How lucky am I that it took me 26 years to meet somebody that had been infected with this disease? So, what's the deal? Why am I so lucky? Why do we live in the greatest of times? Ellen already touched on this. We have something called the scientific method, right? And here's my picture. She had a different picture. Here's my picture, right? So what is the scientific method? It's displayed here quite clearly. You start out with an observation, right? And your observation can be anything. It can be something super duper profound, or it can be something very simple. The example I always give to my Chem 101 students is red cars drive faster than black cars. There, that's my observation, right? And from there, I might start asking questions. Well, why do red cars go faster than black cars? And I form a hypothesis. And a hypothesis is what we call a testable statement. Now, the point of the scientific process is not to support your hypothesis necessarily. It's just as important to throw out your hypothesis. That's important as well. So a hypothesis is nothing more than a testable statement. So perhaps my testable statement about my vehicles are, red car drivers are more pissed off than black car drivers. Right? There's my testable statement. I can test that. I can measure pissed offness, right? And so I'm going to do that. And so that the process of testing your hypothesis is referred to as experimentation, right? So I'm going to design an experiment. So my experiment is I'm going to stand at the end of my driveway, and I'm going to stop all the red and black cars that drive by, and I'm going to say, hey, man, are you pissed off? Right? And as I do that, I'm going to be analyzing my thoughts and thinking about what's happening. And you can already guess that I'm going to have this very flawed experiment, right? Because by the time I stop people during their busy day, everybody that I ask is pissed off, right? So I have to go back to my hypothesis. My hypothesis, I didn't get any concluding information from, right? So I reform my hypothesis, my new testable statement. Red cars are lighter than black cars, right? And so I design a new experiment. And my new experiment is to measure the masses of these red and black cars. And I find that there's no difference. And I find that out in analyzing the results. And so I go back, and I make a new hypothesis. And I design an experiment, I test that. And I go back, and again, 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 right? All the while, I am communicating my results, right, through the various means that Ellen was talking about. And I'm drawing conclusions, and I'm going back, and I'm revisiting this. Now, this is how we teach it. Ellen had a diagram. I have this diagram. Doesn't it look so linear and so nice and so easy? No. Right? No? Okay. Yes, the answer is yes. Yes, it does. Okay, good. Exactly. And what I always tell my students every semester, this is like one of my very first lectures, whenever I'm teaching the scientific method, because I have a similar diagram that my textbook provides, I always say, I freaking hate these pictures. I hate these diagrams of the scientific method. Why? Because the scientific method is not that linear, is not that straightforward, and it is not necessarily that easy, right? So I much prefer this picture. Now, I don't have a high-res version, but you get the point, right? So what is actually the scientific method? Well, let's say I'm a scientist and I'm working in a lab and I have a specific problem where I'm trying to cure some disease. So I'm working in my lab and I'm doing certain things and I'm mixing chemicals together and I got beakers and I got pipettes and I got all those cool sciencey things and I got my lab coat, right? And I'm banging away and I bang away for hours. And while I'm working in the lab, I'm figuring this out, I'm figuring that out, I'm talking to the people in my lab, and I'm saying, hey, I'm seeing this. Do you think this is right? No, that's not right. Maybe I should try this. Have you thought about this? Okay, maybe I'll go back and do that again. And so I spend hours in the lab, right? And I go back and forth, and I talk to those people. And I talk to my boss, right, the principal investigator, or my professor, or if I'm working in an industrial site, my boss, right? And I just talk to them. And I'm seeing this, and I'm not seeing that, and somebody said to do this, and maybe I should do this, and okay, I'm going to go do that, right? So weeks go on, months go on, and maybe after that time, I come up with something that's worthy to present at a scientific conference. And so the scientific conference is usually geared towards people that are in my field, and I go and I have my poster, and I say, okay, I've done this, and I've thought about this, and I did that, and I got these conclusions. And then the person talking to me is like, have you thought about this? Well, I did this, and I found this, or you did that, and that seems flawed. You shouldn't do that. Maybe you should go back and think about this. And I'm like, okay, go back to my lab. do more work, right? Do this, that, the other. Maybe after a couple of years of doing all that stuff, maybe, just maybe, then I have enough to write a paper, what Ellen was talking about. And I'm going to go publish it in a scholarly journal, and specifically, hopefully, a peer-reviewed scholarly journal. So I write up my paper and I submit it. So what does it mean to be submitted to a peer-reviewed journal? Well, that means experts in my field, and not just experts in my field, not just chemists, not just physical chemists, not just computational theoretical physical chemists, but scientists that are doing almost exactly what I do are going to be the ones that we call referee that paper. And they're going to read it. And they're going to say, nope, this is crap, or you should have done this, or you did this pretty well. Do more of this. And they're going to reject my paper and send it back to me. So I'm going to spend more time in the lab. I'm going to do this, that, and the other. And then I'll update my paper. And then maybe when I resubmit it, maybe, just maybe, then it gets published. And now it's out there in a journal. And then who's reading the journals? Well, like, exactly like Ellen said, experts in the field. Not necessarily people doing exactly what I'm doing, but other chemists, right? Or other physical chemists. And then they're reading it. And they're thinking about what I'm doing. And so they're going back to their labs, and they're doing all of the same stuff I was doing in my lab on my project because I sparked some interest in them. And they're doing it. And they're going to conferences. And they're trying to write their own papers, right? And then maybe after years, decades of work, maybe then you have some kind of consensus, right? That's the scientific method. And that's why I hate those diagrams, because the diagrams don't capture any of that. But we're in an interesting time, right? We're in an interesting time. We're in a great time, but we're in an interesting time. Because while that is the scientific method that supposedly happens in science, you know, the public gets it, right? And it gets the information. And Ellen was talking about that, right? So you have this peer-reviewed journal article. It gets picked up by the New York Times. They write a blog post on it. And then all of a sudden, the nightly news is telling you that you should be not drinking red Kool-Aid because there's a correlation between red Kool-Aid and hyperactivity, right? And it oversimplifies things. And so not only are we living in that age, but we're living in an age where the public has redefined, reassessed the scientific method, right? And this is what the scientific method looks like for a lot of people not in the sciences, right? So screw number one, right? Instead of asking questions, you find yourself with no new texts, tweets, or emails. What a horrible state to be in, right? So instead of doing background research, you check your phone. Instead of constructing a testable sentence, you read half an article about something you can make, try, and just apply that will definitely detoxify your skin, help you lose weight, prevent autism, and or cure or prevent cancer. Right? Then instead of testing your hypothesis by doing experiments, you post the link on Facebook and ask if anyone's tried it and where you can buy ingredients. And then number five, throwing out analyzing your data and drawing conclusions. You might be so compelled, because you're an expert now, because you read half an article, right? You might be so compelled to write an article yourself for the Huffington Post about your discovery, emphasizing how many toxins are removed in whatever process you've discovered. Then you link it to Twitter, Pinterest, Facebook, Tumblr, Snapchat, right? And then instead of communicating your results, you call out the haters, right? So that's our current scientific method in which we're working with. And we're all having fun with it, right? We're all having fun with it. You're giggling because you're probably guilty of it. Or if you're not personally guilty of it, you have friends or family that are guilty of it, right? And so we're all having good fun with this. But I want to bring up a quote from a professor from my alma mater, Boston University, Isaac Asimov. Go Terriers. He was a professor of biochemistry at Boston University. He died in the early 90s. He's most famous for being a science fiction writer, as a matter of fact. And so in writing science fiction and things like that, there's this famous quote from him. Anti-intellectualism has been a constant thread winding its way through our political and cultural life, nurtured by the false notion that democracy means that my ignorance is as good as your knowledge. Right? And I'm sure we've all experienced this, and I'm sure we all have very, very good examples of this. Okay, so where am I going with this? I have to talk pseudoscience, I have to talk science denialism, right? But I had to give you that background information. And before I can talk pseudoscience, and before I can talk scientific denialism, before I present those things, because I'm going to ruffle a lot of feathers in here tonight, I can already tell, okay? We have to go through the Girl Scout promise. Now, when I was a Girl Scout, back in, I'm not going to date myself like Ellen, back in something, 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 it was not 1969, okay? Whenever we would start our troop meetings, we would always start with the Girl Scout promise. Now, we're not going to do the Girl Scout promise, we're going to do the Science Scout promise. Ready? Okay, so it's kind of like the Girl Scout promise. So repeat after me. Ready? On my honor, I will try to not get pissed off when Dr. Napoleon challenges one of my beliefs. Even if I've had that belief for a really, really long time, and even if I really, really believe it, and to live by the Girl Scout law. Okay, thank you. Now we can talk pseudoscience. Ready? All right. So Ellen already gave you a definition. Here's the definition I'm working with. Pseudoscience consists of claims, beliefs, or practices presented as being plausible scientifically, but which are not justified by the scientific method. That's pseudoscience. Now, I'm going to show you a list of pseudoscientific ideas. Again, I may ruffle some feathers. Ready? Okay. So here's my list. Where's my little pointer? Okay, here we go. You've probably heard of some of these. You've probably partaken in some of these. No judgment, right? You didn't know before you came to my talk tonight, right? Pretty famous acupuncture, right? What else do we got here? Colon cleansing. Brain types. Did anybody go to the faculty lecture earlier today that was all about, yeah? Brain types. So brain types are being thrown out, right? Learning types, right? You know how you're like, oh no, I only learn through reading. I can't listen to people. You know how you do that? It's defunct, right? That's thrown out. So that's brain types. Homeopathy, intelligent design, moon landing conspiracy theories, and so on. This is actually a slide that I updated this morning. I finished my slides last night, but I was having breakfast at the SBCC cafeteria this morning, and I remembered something that the cafeteria was selling, and I was like, gotta update that slide, okay, and I updated it with alkalized water. And so here's the picture I took this morning of alkalized water being sold by, excuse me, our school's cafeteria. So what is alkalized water? It's basically water, excuse me again, that's at a high pH, meaning that it's basic. Now, water is usually considered neutral, and so this is basic water. Now, why do we have basic water? What is the claims? Why are people selling this? They're selling this because they say that you recover faster after physical performance, right? So whenever you have physical performance, whenever you run or lift weights or anything like that, you have a buildup of lactic acid in the muscles and things like that. And so the idea is, well, if you eat or drink something basic, it will neutralize the stuff in your blood and become that much, and you'll recover that much faster. Now, this is completely junk science, right? Anybody that knows how the body actually works knows that by the time that this stuff gets past your gut, it's not getting into the blood, and that's not what actually is neutralizing what's in your blood, right? Your kidneys are doing a lot of that. So it costs $250, you know? Choose your own adventure, as I always say. If you want to buy this, if I run into you tomorrow in the cafeteria and you're buying it, no judgment, I'm just saying. It might not do what you think it does. And I'd like to call a couple of these out, just really quickly. I know I've already called out a couple. Biodynamical agriculture. In looking this one up, because I didn't know what it was at first, it's actually what current practices of organic farming are based on. I'm not saying that organic farming is pseudoscience. I'm saying what it's based on is pseudoscience. Those are profoundly different things. Biodynamical agriculture, what I looked up and found out, is that it, ready, emphasizes spiritual and mystical perspectives in agriculture. That's what biodynamical culture is. So you go out, you know, you have a, you know, your farm has a certain juju that you just like feel and you just think about, right, before you plant those seeds and before you water them. Naturopathy, where is it? They're in alphabetical order, right here. This is a big one. And in fact, when I Googled a lot of these to figure out what some of them were, I was really annoyed because almost every single one had a local Santa Barbara company that like specializes in it. And naturopathy was a big one. There's lots of naturopathic doctors. It's an alternative medicine where disease can be is treated slash prevented without drugs through control of diet, exercise, and massage. And so I'll come back to that one in a little bit. This one got me, Rolfing. Because all I could think of was that bad internet acronym, rolling on the floor laughing, right? That's all I could think about. I was like, what does that have to do with it? Rolfing is aligning the body's energy field with Earth's magnetic field. Uses deep manual movement prompts. Quote, can sometimes be painful. Awesome. Not only is it junk science, but it can also kind of hurt. Sign me up, right? Okay, so that's pseudoscience. That's some examples of pseudoscience. And so what is science denialism? They're obviously related, right? Clearly. Science denialism is the rejection of basic facts and concepts that are undisputed, well-supported part of the scientific consensus on a subject in favor of radical, controversial, or unsupported ideas. Okay, so there's our working definitions of this stuff. Okay. So I just want to take a step back for a minute and just recap. We live in the greatest time in human history, right? What's one of the biggest accomplishments of humans thus far? I would argue that scientific method, right? And so before I move on, I'd like to quote and misquote a famous scientist, Richard Dawkins. So Richard Dawkins is a well-known biologist. And he has to say, vaccines, modern medicine, are products of what is known as the scientific method. Planes fly, cars drive, computers compute, thanks to the scientific method. If you develop medicine on science and utilize the scientific method, you cure people. If you design rockets in this way, they reach the moon. This is an exact quote. Scientific method, it works, bitches. Okay, so we have the scientific method. We live in the greatest of times. However, currently, more than a billion people are hungry, right? So despite everything, despite our accomplishments, despite our cars that drive and our cell phones that call and our vaccines that prevent diseases, we have over a billion people going to bed at night hungry. And I'm not even getting into the other stuff yet. I'm not getting into the way where we trash water. I'm not getting into the way where we trash our environment, right? I'm not even going there yet. I'm just talking about this one thing. Unless we figure out stuff and figure it out quickly, people are going to continue to starve, and they're going to starve to death, right? This is a problem that we are currently facing. And by the way, it's not just in far-off places. Look here, developed country, 15 million people in developed countries, right? We should be absolutely ashamed of ourselves, right? And I believe we can do it. We have the scientific method. We have the technology. There's no reason why we can't do this stuff, right? And I don't think I'm a dreamer. I don't think I'm, you know, I don't think I'm some person that doesn't understand the way the world works or anything like that. We've never had the scientific capabilities that we have today. We've never had the technology that we've had today. We can do amazing things in a wide variety of fields, but we're fighting against ourselves all the time. And we're fighting ourselves all the time through acceptance of pseudoscience and normalization of it and scientific denialism. You probably have to go back hundreds of years to revisit a time or find a time where people have been as argumentative of proof as we are today, okay? People like their beliefs. They hold on to them strongly. You were probably already pissed off at me about my list of pseudoscience, right? She's wrong, I know, right? I've been taking, you know, my mom's cough syrup for years, right? And it always cures my flu, right? People hold on to their beliefs, people hold on to their perceptions, they strongly believe these things, even when it's contrary to the facts that are presented to them, and even sometimes when it's contrary to physical law. Right? And fine. We're a free country. You do you, boo. Right? Everyone's entitled to their opinions. There's this saying, right? Opinions are like belly buttons or some other body part. I can't remember the exact quote, right? Everybody has one. You're entitled to your opinions. You're entitled to whatever Snapchat filter you like best, right? You can wear your crop tops with your platform boots. You can let your freak flag fly. You live in a free country. But I hate to be the one to tell you this. I'm sure you've heard this before. You are not entitled to your own facts or your alternative facts, right? And yet we're seeing this all the time. Vaccines are one of the greatest public health inventions in human history. It has saved millions, if not billions, of people. And yet we see and hear opposition to vaccines all the time. Where did it come from? How did it start? Right? And before I move on, I just want to say, maybe some of you are a little young for this reference, so I just wanted to update the reference, okay? Just so that you knew what I was talking about. And if that still doesn't work for you, I updated it further. So now that we're all on the same page, I'll move on. Yeah? Okay. So who is this? This is a famous physician. Anybody know who this is? Andrew Wakefield. Here he is in all his glory. In 1998, Andrew Wakefield published a paper in a highly respected, well-known journal known as The Lancet about the MMR vaccine, which is the measles, mumps, and rubella vaccine, that linked the MMR vaccine to autism and bowel disease. This was frightening to people, and as it should be, right? That's a big deal. Lots of people are getting and were getting vaccines. We should take this very seriously. He found results. He communicated them. The scientific community should respond, and they did, right? Thousands of studies were done in response to this particular paper. Thousands of studies were done by people at universities, people in industry, people in government. The publications were coming from all over the world, not only the US and Canada, but Western Europe, Japan, right? All over the world. And it was all the same. No correlation, no connection, none. So this is what I'm talking about, right? None of that matters. We hold on to our anecdotes. We hold on to our beliefs. Why don't we trust scientists? Why don't we trust that process? You probably have your own examples, right? Name one. Chernobyl, right? Scientists got it wrong. Name another. Vioxx, right? Vioxx was a scary medication that Merck produced in about the late 90s, early 2000s. They covered up the data that showed that Vioxx, which was a COX-2 inhibitor, so it helped you with pain, right? People were taking it for orthopedic pain. It was linked to serious heart problems. People were dying, and Merck covered it up. I get it. I can name a few more, right? And so can you. Agent Orange. Cigarettes, right? We've been lied to. We all have our own lists. There's big problems with this, right? And it pulled people's faith away from things. But here's the problem. When you're given evidence from multiple sources, from multiple people, from around the world, from varying institutions, you need to accept that proof. Now, I'm not saying don't be skeptical, and I'm not saying don't ask questions. You should demand the evidence. But damn it, when you're given the evidence, accept it. And we're really sucking at that right now, right? So what have been the results? So here's Andrew Wakefield. What are the results? What did we see? Well, for the MMR vaccine to be effective, the inoculation rate, the herd immunity, you hear this a lot, needs to hover between 90% and 95%, meaning 90% to 95% of the population needs to be inoculized by this. So here in time is when the Wakefield published the study, and you see it dip, right? You see it go down, right? People lost faith. Right? They knew there was this link, and despite evidence to the contrary, they held on to their belief, and the inoculation rate dipped well below. And it's starting to come back up, right? I didn't have new data, I didn't have a new graph, so I just went with this one. It's starting to go back up. Here in Santa Barbara County, we do not have a herd immunity rate. It's under 90%. That should scare you, because at this point, it's just a numbers game between now and when measles come back, right? So here's vaccination rates by state. And again, I don't have updated data. I was just pulling stuff off the web, so it's a little bit old, 2013 to 2014 school year. Here we are in good old California, right? everybody's tan, liberal neighbor, right? California. And you can see that we're probably just under that herd immunity rate back then, right? And other states are doing pretty well. Some are doing worse than us, some are doing better, but here's the data, right? So after this fallacious study, after this defunct study, by the way, Andrew Wakefield, it came out later on that he was being paid by companies to write this fake study. That's been well documented. We saw the coverage of the MMR vaccine dip, right? And you're saying, well, yeah, who cares? Yeah, the herd immunity is there. You're telling me it's only a matter of time, but it hasn't happened yet, so I don't care, right? Go back to my daily business. Well, here's the deal. In 2015, 134,200 people died of measles in the world. That's about 15 people per hour dying of a preventable disease. Measles is more, more contagious than the flu, okay? Again, it's only a matter of time. And as a matter of fact, it's only a matter of time for us, but it's already happening in Europe. This is a headline that I took from the BBC just last week during spring break, measles outbreak across Europe. They're currently seeing the ramifications of scientific denialism and specifically vaccination denialism. So according to the World Health Organization, the major measles break is happening in Italy. And this is a quote from them, more than 700 cases of measles have been registered already this year compared to 220 in the same period last year. More than double, right? 85.3% of Italian children have the measles vaccine, well below herd immunity. If you haven't seen this headline yet, you're going to continue to see it. Okay. So why is this happening? Andrew Wakefield wasn't that famous until his paper. Many of you didn't even recognize him, right? So what's happening? People like this get involved. Who's this? Jenny McCarthy. Huh? She's an actress. Absolutely, she's an actress. Jenny McCarthy. And Jenny McCarthy took it upon herself to take this discussion and preach it from platforms like Oprah or a book, right? Or anyone that would listen to her, CNN. And why is that? Because she doesn't understand what Ellen was getting at earlier. Correlation is not causation. So let's look very quickly about where she was thinking about getting her information from, or not thinking about it, but where was she getting her information from? So here's birth year at the bottom, okay? Number of enrolled persons with autism. And so what do you see in the US and what do you see in the UK? You see a huge increase of the number of people with autism in both of those places, right? And so people started asking questions. Well, why? Right? Why are we seeing autism more? And there's lots and lots of theories to that. And one of the theories was, and you can see from this graph, is that right about here, right before this stark uptick, right? We started having the MMR vaccine in America, and we started having it in the UK. So clearly, that must be the issue, right? Clearly, it's the MMR vaccine, and that's what it is, right? But correlation is not causation. And you can tell Ellen and I are really good friends in real life, because for the love of God, here's my graph that I was going to go with this, right? But I must love spurious correlations a teeny bit more than you, because actually, in addition to this one, which we already saw and talked about, I also pulled up this one, right? Yeah, this was your second choice. See, real life friends, right? We go, we're like this, right? So number of people who drowned by falling into a pool, correlating with films Nicolas Cage appeared in. And look at this correlation. I mean, it's awesome. Look at that. I mean, this one is like, you know, I mean, this one's pretty vanilla, right? You know, this one's awesome. Look at that complicated stuff. And what was going on in this year, right? I mean, so anyways, correlation is not causation. And if you don't like the graphs, how about a cartoon? Here's my cartoon. Everyone who went to the moon has eaten chicken. There's a Venn diagram, Mark. There you go, right? Good grief, chicken makes us go to the moon, right? Well, what if Jenny McCarthy had looked at this graph instead? Autism, right, by year. Organic food sales, right? It has nothing to do with the MMR vaccine. Clearly, it has to do with organic food sales, right? Or what if she looked at this graph? Autism correlates directly with her own fame. I think we found the culprit, yeah? And it's not just, and it's, you know, this is complicated, and I get it, right? Autism is a scary disease for some people, right? That's a scary diagnosis for a lot of parents. I don't necessarily agree with that, but I get it, right? And part of the reason why it's so scary is because for a long time we didn't know where it was coming from. We didn't know what caused it. We didn't understand whether it was something environmental like vaccines or something we were doing or something we were eating or just simply dumb luck thanks to our genes, right? We didn't know. But here's the thing. People are currently taking this one step further, and not only are they correlating ridiculous things such as this and such as the MMR vaccine to autism, but they're also correlating vaccines now, because everybody is so freaked out to things that we is well established where it comes from. I Googled this last night. Vaccine causes shaken baby syndrome. Now, for the love of God, we know where shaken baby syndrome comes from. If you are still unclear, it comes from shaking babies, okay? So I Googled this last night. This was literally my Google last night, and I took a screenshot for you. Look at this. Every single Google result, right? When is shaken baby syndrome possibly vaccine injury instead? Shaken baby syndrome, National Vaccine Information Center. Shaken baby syndrome often caused by vaccines, not parents. Dangerous vaccines found to cause symptoms of shaken babies, right? A disease that we know about. We're so freaked out by vaccines. We've heard over and over and over that there might be these bad correlations, and so we're throwing out all rational thought and all evidence that's being presented to us, and we're going to this. That's bad, right? And it's not just rogue doctors, and it's not just celebrities. It's also our president. This was the best picture I could find of him. No, I'm just joking. This was the best picture I could find of him. No, I'm just joking. This was the best picture I could find of him. And okay, that's mean. All right, I found a different picture of him. All right. The last one. Here we go. That's really the best picture I found of him. That's his Twitter photo. Okay. And speaking of his Twitter photo, and speaking of his Twitter, here's a very famous tweet coming from our current president in 2014. Healthy young child goes to doctor, gets pumped with massive shot of many vaccines, doesn't feel good, and changes. Autism! He has to capitalize something in there, right? Many such cases. Retweets, likes, right? You see these stats? 2014, years after the defunct 1998 paper, right? And it's not just vaccines. I'm focusing this talk on vaccines because that's an easy target, but how about climate change? Something that is also well accepted by the scientific community. Here's a tweet from just a few years ago, right? This is a very famous tweet. The concept of global warming was created by and for the Chinese in order to make the US manufacturing non-competitive. And we're not just hearing it from our president. We're not just hearing it from doctors and celebrities. We're also hearing it from other politicians, right? Does anybody know who this is? Jim Inhofe, a senator from Oklahoma. I don't know if he currently is, but at least at this time when he was giving this speech with this snowball in his hand, he was the chairman of the Senate's Environment and Public Works Committee. Here's what he had to say, and I quote, "In case we've forgotten, because we keep hearing 2014 has been the warmest year on record, do you know what this is? This is a snowball, just from outside here. So it's very, very cold out. Very unseasonable." And then he tossed the snowball. Let me explain what he's saying. He's saying that global climate change does not exist because it was frickin' December and he could go outside and get a snowball in Washington, D.C. That's like saying global hunger doesn't exist because here I have this ham sandwich. Right? That is his argument. Now, I would argue that it's not a very sound argument. And like Ellen was getting to earlier, this is a politician, not a scientist. I don't want to hear science coming from this guy, right? And I especially don't want to hear science denialism. So who do I want to hear science from? Who do I want to hear about vaccines from? I'd really like to hear about vaccines from this guy. Paul Offit, Dr. Paul Offit. He's an American pediatrician. Sorry, I couldn't get a better picture of him. He specializes in infectious diseases. He's an expert on vaccines, immunology, and virology. He is the co-inventor of something called the rotavirus vaccine. My son got it when he was about 6 months old. Rotavirus causes horrible diarrhea and throwing up. I didn't even want to write them all. I didn't even want to memorize them. He's been awarded with numerous prestigious awards, appointments, and is credited because of his vaccine developments with saving the lives of thousands, if not millions, of people. He's also been the target of violence. He has continuously provided armed guards when he attends the Federal Health Advisory Committee meetings. Why? Because he's in vaccine development. And he promotes vaccines. And so when I Googled for this picture, right next to this picture was this picture, this meme. I'm Paul Offit. I own vaccine patents, which is true. He's developed them. I make millions off mandating my poison into your children. You're welcome. I could not Google this man's name without his credibility being attacked, right? And this should piss you off a little bit. And if this doesn't piss you off, I'll give you another example. Lyme disease. Lyme disease is a disease that affects about 200,000 people every year. You can see where it's affecting people, okay? It's really bad in the Northeast. I actually have several friends in Boston that have had Lyme disease and have some successfully, some unsuccessfully treated it. But it's here in California. This is the telltale deer tick that causes the disease that carries the bacteria. And this is the clear indication that you have the Lyme disease. What's the deal with Lyme disease? If you're not familiar with it, fever, you feel tired, you have joint pain. Some people, even though they get years of treatment, it doesn't work for some people. Now in 1998, remember that year? In 1998, a pharmaceutical company known as Smith, Kline, Beecham developed a vaccine for it. They worked on it. They invested billions of dollars in it, years of work. And it got through the peer review process. It got through the clinical trials. Hundreds of vaccine recipients reported that they developed an autoimmune side effects and health problems because of this vaccine. The FDA and the CDC took this very seriously, and they did their own independent investigations. And despite lack of evidence showing that any of that was true, they pulled the vaccine. Let me repeat that. The CDC and the FDA did their own independent investigations. There was no correlation, no causation found between the Lyme disease vaccine and the autoimmune symptoms that people were claiming. And yet the vaccine was pulled. You cannot get this vaccine today. Your dog can, you cannot. This disease is only going to get worse, and it's only going to infect more and more people. During that time, an editorial in Nature came out. Nature is one of the premier science magazines. Quote, unfounded public fears place pressure on vaccine developments that go beyond reasonable safety considerations. The quote goes on to say, this just shows how irrational the world can be. There was no scientific justification for this vaccine to be pulled. So we don't have it today. Right? Who's this? Gwyneth Paltrow, right? Another actress. Her current endeavor is developing a website called goop.com. I don't know why the hell she called it that, but we're going with it, okay? On her website, she promotes what's called vaginal steaming. Direct quote, steam your vagina like broccoli. Try it. And then she smiles. She claims that she promotes wellness. Now, as the owner of a vagina, I'm not sure that I see the correlation between steaming the vagina and promoting wellness, but let's hear what she has to say about why she's moving in this direction. Unfortunately, when you lose a parent to cancer, you want to stave off the illness. You want to embrace life and prolong your life. I've come from that place for a long time because I've had illness in my family. So somehow she got from dad dies of cancer to vagina steaming. Now remember, my dad died of cancer. I'm not there yet. Give me time, I guess. How about this guy? Steve Jobs. What did he do? He died. Before he died. Co-founder of Apple? Huh? He didn't? I didn't know that. Okay, well, co-founder of Apple, didn't bathe properly. CEO of Apple, pioneer of personal computing. In October of 2003, as somebody mentioned, he did die, not in the 2003, but in October of 2003, he was diagnosed with pancreatic cancer. Now, usually pancreatic cancer is pretty deadly and pretty quickly. Steve Jobs was very, very lucky. He had a rare kind of pancreatic cancer, and it was a rare form that didn't kill people. He had a very good prognosis. Even though he had a very good prognosis, he completely resisted doctors' recommendations and decided that instead of listening to them and doing what they wanted them, him to do in terms of their treatment, he was going to cure it through natural healing and diet. Specifically, he picked up a vegan diet, he picked up acupuncture, he picked up herbal remedies, he saw psychics. And then he even did juice fast to try and cure his cancer. Now, unfortunately, none of this worked, of course, right? And his doctors tried to tell him none of this is going to work. By the time he figured out it wasn't working, it was too late. He had let his cancer go on too far, and ultimately he died in 2011. A Harvard researcher, Ramzi Amir, said his choice of alternative treatments led to an unnecessary and early death. A doctor from Sloan Kettering in New York City, world premier cancer treatment facility, says Jobs' faith in alternative medicine cost him his life. He had the only kind of pancreatic cancer that is treatable and curable. He essentially committed suicide. Now, you're probably judging Steve Jobs, and maybe rightly so, right? And you're probably judging, like I am, Gwyneth Paltrow and Andrew Wakefield and the other girl, what's her name, Jenny McCarthy, right? You're probably judging them. But I don't necessarily care about them per se. I mean, I do. I've already impressed upon you, hopefully, how big their effects can be, right? But what I'm getting at here is that pseudoscience acceptance, and specifically science denialism, is not unique to the specific people I've talked about. It's ubiquitous. We're all guilty of it, right? Anyone take a multivitamin today? Buy a drink with antioxidants in it? Probiotics? You probably did. I know this because based on consumer data, 68% of adults take a dietary supplement every day. Think about that, 68% of people. You take vitamins, you listen to the antioxidants, you go to the cafeteria, you buy your $2.50 worth of alkalized water, you buy your homeopathic remedies, right, when you get a cold or a flu to cure your cold and you cure your flu. We all do this. Consumer studies have shown us this. And it doesn't matter how much evidence comes out that says all of this stuff is crap, we still buy it and we still take it. 84% of Americans express overall confidence in the effectiveness of these things. $21 billion last year was spent on vitamins and alternative medicine. Think about that for a second. The only thing that these things have ever proven to work or do is make your pee funny colors. That's it, right? And yet, here we are spending our hard-earned cash on it. Big pharma, let's talk about big placebo, right? Bam, all about the money. And talking about what Ellen was talking about earlier is when we're not just in trouble because of our acceptance and rituals with alternative medicine. How about this? Anybody, you all laughed.
That's Santa Barbara. Lying.
Exactly. Sure.
All the money.
Sure. But this has been shared on Facebook, on my Facebook feed, more than I'd like to admit. Right? I've seen this over and over and over. Oh, so many of my mom's friends were like, tee-hee, I don't have to go to the gym. I can just drink wine, right? Glass of red wine is the equivalent to an hour at the gym, says new study. Well, let's look at what the new study actually says. Here's what the new study actually says. Improvements in skeletal muscle strength and cardiac function induced by resveratrol during exercise training contributes to enhanced exercise performance in rats. Holy shit. Right? How did they go from there to here? Right? Here's what the study actually showed. Now, the compound of interest is a compound in red wine. That's true. I'm not denying that. It is in red wine. It showed that the endurance capacity is enhanced in rats who diet include resveratrol during a 12-week endurance training program. It increased the endurance. and the results established that this compound is an effective ergogenic aid that enhances exercise performance over exercise alone. Great. You know what they did? They took this compound out, they isolated it, they gave high doses to rats, and then they measured their cardiovascular capability. Right? Rats aren't great models for humans. They're pretty good, they're a great place to start, but I don't know how you went from here, or rather from here to here. Right? And maybe like somebody shouted out, maybe it's to pay bills or maybe it's to get money. I don't know what. I don't know what drives, you know, maybe clicks, right? Clickbait. We hear about that a lot. But again, we're all guilty of this. Alternative medicine, believing crap headlines, chemical phobia, right? Chemical-free carrots. Somebody explain to me how that works, right? I'm pretty sure you need water to grow carrots. I'm pretty sure water's a chemical. I didn't go to school for all those years to say that water's not a chemical, right? Water is definitely a chemical. Here's a local picture. Chemical-free farms. How does that work? Do the plants not take up CO2? Right? CO2 is a chemical. Do they not give off O2? Right? Do they not water the plants? What? How can this be? Right? And yet, we go to the farmers markets. We go to the Whole Foods stores, right, that promote these claims, that are selling their stuff on crap, right? So I always like to show this. I always show this in my chemistry class. I wish I could show you the list for carrots so that you could believe me that there's chemicals in carrots. But maybe we'll look at kiwis or bananas really quickly. So if we put the ingredients list on kiwis, look at this long list of things. There's preservatives in there. There's synthetic colors. Now, they're not synthetic, but they're naturally occurring that we can then synthesize. So these are their names, right? We have some flavors, right? I don't even know what that is, right? Stuff, lots and lots of stuff, lots and lots of scary sounding stuff. And the same thing with bananas. You know what bananas have? My Chem 101 students should know this. Come on, guys. What do bananas have in them? Cyanide. What does cyanide do to you? Kills you. How? Asphyxiates you. Asphyxiates you. You suffocate, right? It's in bananas. It's naturally occurring. Cyanide's natural. Maybe it cures cancer, right? That's the jump we are often making. And you're going, you know, what's the big deal? Why do you care? Napoleon, you're going off the deep end on this stuff. What's the harm? This is clearly bothering you. It keeps you up at night, you know. Maybe you should just calm down a little bit. I care because we're replacing scientific evidence. We're replacing well-supported scientific data with superstitions, magic, and bullpucky, frankly. And that is a bad place to be, because here's where you end up. Does anybody know who this man is? President Thabo Mbeki of South Africa. He claims that HIV doesn't cause AIDS. He has continuously blocked antivirals from coming into the country. He is estimated to have killed, with his policies, over 400,000 people. What does he say will cure AIDS? Garlic, beetroot, beetroots, and lemon juice. That's what he says will cure AIDS. Thanks to his rhetoric, thanks to things that he's saying, people are dying, and that's bad, right? So yeah, why do I care? Because people are dying. People's health is effective. And it's not just happening in far-off places like South Africa. This happened in San Diego. A friend shared this on my Facebook wall a couple weeks ago. Naturopathic doctors look bad after California woman dies from turmeric injection. Now, I hate this headline. To me, they looked bad far before this, right? Naturopathic doctors look bad after California woman dies from turmeric injection. Anybody know what turmeric is? It's a spice. It's a spice. Her doctor made an IV with turmeric and put it in her, and she subsequently died, right? There's ramifications to adhering to scientific denialism. There's ramifications of alternative medicine, right? Here's another common one. I have friends back in Boston doing this one. Coffee enemas. You're welcome, okay? So it's a coffee enema. You make coffee and you put it in your butt. Exactly. Okay, there's no, that's it. That's the way you say it. You make coffee, you put it in the butt. Now, what's the problem with that? What's the problem with that other than, you know, wasting good coffee? Infections, sepsis, electrolyte imbalance, colitis, salmonella, brain abscess, rectal perforation, heart failure, death, right? So you may have been judging this woman. I would never put a spice in an IV bag and inject it in my veins. But if you Google coffee enemas, and I encourage you to do it, okay? You will find website after website after website making claims that this does something. And it doesn't, I almost said does nothing, but I already listed you what it does, right? Another one that drives me bananas that I can go on and on and on and on and on about is GMOs. Genetically modified organisms. This one drives me crazy, and I don't get to talk about it a lot because I'm a chemist and I'm not a geneticist. And man, if I could do it all over again, maybe I would become a geneticist. This is a big one for me. I Googled GMOs. This was the first picture I got, right? So this is what you see when you Google genetically modified organisms. There is a broad scientific consensus that the food derived from genetically modified, or excuse me, GM engineering provides no greater risk than conventional food. This has been well established, ready, by the World Health Organization, the American Academy for the Advancement of Sciences, the European Commission on Food and Safety, the US FDA, and the list goes on and on and on and on of scientific, well-respected scientific organizations that say that this is not any more dangerous than conventional food. Everything you eat today has been genetically modified by man. Christmas trees didn't exist a couple hundred years ago. Broccoli didn't exist, right? Now we can do it more precisely. And yeah, there's risks. There's risk with everything you do. But let me tell you something. We can take vitamin A and put it in rice, which is a staple for millions of people around the world, and not only save their vision, but we can also save their life so that they're not living in poverty. And you're going to tell me you don't want to do that? You're going to tell me that we shouldn't proceed with investigating GMO food? You're going to tell me that it's frankenfood, that it's not natural, when this is a technique that has been investigated by universities, industrials, governments, thousands of scientists around the world in an interdisciplinary fashion? Man, you don't have a leg to stand on, right? And you're going to tell me, well, there's pesticides. Right? There's pesticides. It promotes pesticides. And you're going to tell me there's monoculture, right? And you're going to tell me, well, we don't want life to be patented, right? And we don't want Monsanto to patent things, right? Monsanto's evil. Fine, right? Let's work on those things. Monoculture isn't unique to GMOs. Pesticides aren't unique to GMOs, right? You're conflating issues. Let's work on those things, and let's work on them together, and let's move forward, and let's stop having a billion people go to bed at night hungry. Last night, I went to PubMed, a very famous search engine that is provided to us by the United States government. And all I did was I typed in genetically modified organisms. There has been, where is it? Right here. 48,406 studies of peer-reviewed studies done on GMOs. That's a lot of studies. Let me find my number. How many studies have been done on climate change? 27,000. 27,000. Almost twice as many on GMOs, right? Not quite, but almost twice as many done on GMOs. We're investigating it. We understand it. There's a lot of questions still, but a lot have been answered, right? So let's work on this, right? And let's stop with this crap. 8-day reset. Lose 5 to 15 pounds in 8 days naturally. I did the math for you. Ready? A pound is equal to 3,500 calories. My Chem 101 students can definitely do this. I know it. 15 pounds is equal to 52,500 calories. Therefore, you need a deficit of 6,562.5 calories a day to lose 15 pounds in 8 days. So even if you stop eating, drink only water, and run for 4 hours a day, if you're a 180-pound man, you're still not going to cut out the 15 pounds. So I don't know what they're doing. I don't know how they're doing it. I have a hunch that it has to do with cutting off limbs, because metabolically, this isn't feasible. So you can call that, or you can go to that website if you'd like, but I'm just saying I'm pretty sure they're cutting things off the human body. Here's a local one. This one drives me bananas. This one's from Lazy Acres. Sorry. Okay. So this is from Lazy Acres. I was shopping there one night, and I was checking out, and I saw this on the checkout stand. Great news. Our receipt paper is BPA free. And I took a picture of it, and I texted my friend Robbie bitching, right? Jesus Christ, Lazy Acres, promoting pseudoscience. What's BPA? Anybody know? It's a plastic. It's It's a plastic that it used to be in a lot of water bottles. It lines all of our tin of our aluminum cans, right, for food. So a couple years ago, we started thinking about BPA, and we started looking at it, and people started getting freaked out by BPA because it is, and let me get this right, let me say it right. How do I say it? An endo... It's escaping me. It's a hormone... thank you. Endocrine disruptor. Right? So we started thinking about it. And people started getting freaked out by it. And so what you started seeing is when you went to go buy water bottles, it would say BPA free. Right? And so we didn't want it in our water bottles because it could leach into the water and then you would be ingesting it. Now what I'd like to point out about BPA is for decades, and here's the figure, 96% of Americans have BPA in their urine. That's a lot of people being exposed to BPA. Right? And so if it's a hormone disruptor, maybe we should look into this. And so we did. And the FDA has come up with a public statement. Both the Natural Toxicology Program at the National Institutes of Health and FDA have some concern about the potential effects of BPA on the brain, behavior, and prostate glands. I'm reading the wrong thing. FDA's current assessment is that BPA is safe at the very low levels that occur in some foods. This assessment is based on review by FDA scientists of hundreds of studies, including the latest findings from new studies initiated by the agency. The FDA has come out time and time again and said that not only does BPA not necessarily do anything to your water bottles or your food or the low levels that you're exposed to, or even though so many people have a detectable amount in their urine, you're still good to go. People didn't want it in their water bottles, right? And then Lazy Acres took it a step further and decided that our receipt paper doesn't need it. Now, I don't know who's ingesting the receipt paper at Lazy Acres, but they have a way bigger problem than BPA, okay? Homeopathy. What's homeopathy? Hear about this one a lot. Yeah. Homeopathy is based on the idea that like cures like. Specifically, a substance that causes disease in healthy people will cure similar symptoms in sick people. Wait, what? Right? Am I high? What? Okay. A big idea in homeopathy is dilution. And dilution to the point where no molecules of the original substance is in the solution of homeopathic itself. It relies on the placebo effect. Now, the placebo effect is a very, very strong effect. In fact, it's so strong that all of our pharmaceuticals have to outperform placebos to even get to you as a consumer. Placebo effect is a real thing. So fine. You want your homeopathy? Fine. Spend your money on it, right? But it's nothing more than the placebo effect. Maybe instead of buying a homeopathic cough syrup, maybe buy Smarties, right? Because at least then they taste good, I think, right? Now, going back to Gwyneth Paltrow, here's what she said about her father. At stage 4 cancer, when her father had it, she said to her father, "Why don't you try homeopathy? let's cross our fingers. For some people, it works. As a matter of fact, for nobody, it really works, outside of the placebo effect." And somebody developed this really, really, really helpful website, www.howdoeshomeopathywork.com. So let's go to it. Security, do I want to continue? Yes. Okay, here we go, launching it. Right? It doesn't. So that's it. That's my talk. Thanks for letting me go over. But before you leave, let me say one thing. Let me leave you with my favorite science quote. I've given you a lot of bad stuff, right? I've slammed lots of different pseudoscience topics, right? I told you I was going to ruffle your feathers. Some of you look pretty pissed off at me, maybe because it's 75 degrees in here and I've talked for more than an hour. But let me leave you with this. I gave you a lot of quotes tonight. This is my favorite science quote of all time. It comes from a Nobel laureate. As you sip your coffee, think about all the science behind it in the agriculture, processing, roasting, and extraction. Then think of all the science around you, in your cell phone, your computer, even your food. Shouldn't everyone be educated to understand the science that permeates your life? and understand it correctly. Right? So with that, I say thank you very much.
Thank you for being here. Let's give them another hand. Professor Carey, Professor Napoleon. And here are our books. We've chosen these books. One is about Socrates, and the other one, well, it's about the future of the human species. So I think the species, you get that one.
Sweet.
And you get the Socrates Cafe, okay? Let's hear it for them again. Thank you.